Great. It's time for our second session. And I can see our panelists already here. And before we begin the session, I would like to say a special thank you to everyone who has joined us. And we have Mr. Jean-Claude joining too. Thank you for joining us. And please share your tweets on social media, share on Twitter with the hashtag CF Live Webinar. And our partners for today's webinar are EOS Data Analytics and Dizengoff Ghana. Dizengoff is giving a special discount package to farmers who sign up to our grower platform. So when you sign up, you have a special discount from Dizengoff. And yes, thank you very much. So we have our panelists ready. Our next session is going to focus on understanding farming seasonalities to match buyer needs. And I believe it's important that as farmers, we know what to do, when to do it, and the kind of processes we need to pay attention to, especially when it comes to meeting demand by our buyers. So our panelists are here. I'll let them briefly introduce themselves so we begin the session. Hello, Jonas. Yeah, hello, Mr. Mohammed. And Mr. Akin Toby. Okay, so whilst waiting for Mr. Akin Toby to join us,
Mr. Akin Toby is live.
Yeah. Great. Hello, Mr. Akin Toby.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. Can we have a brief introduction from our panelists, starting with you, Mr. Akin Toby?
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Akin Toby Olanrewaju. I'm the founder of Lands Farms Nigeria Limited. I'm also a lecturer with the Department of Agricultural Extension and Rural Sociology, Federal University, one of the federal universities in Nigeria. And I'm the Niger farmer on Twitter. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Niger farmer. You can go next, Mr. Mohammed.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I am Mohammed. I'm working with EOS Data Analytics, and I am working as sales manager within the partnership department. Our platforms provide services for crop monitoring and satellite imagery. It's very straightforward, very simple. I would like to send this back to you, and let's take it, I guess, for Toby.
Thank you and welcome. And we have Mr. Jonas. Hello, sir. Yeah, I think you're on mute.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Yeah, my name is Jonas Doho, CEO of John Doe Ventures. We are an agro input company. We are into distribution and retail of agro inputs. When I mean crop protection products, seeds, and crop nutrition products like fertilizers. Yes, basically that's what we do. We are into consultancy also. So you need advice on farm management, on what you do, you contact us. We are the right place to be.
Thank you all for joining us. So today's session, as we said, this session is going to focus on understanding farming seasonalities to match buyer needs. And we are happy because all our panelists represent everything that is on the minds of farmers, from weather, from knowing about pricing, from knowing about availability of input. So if you're a farmer here, this is the right session for you to be part of. So to go straight into today's conversation, I'll begin with you, Mr. Akin Toby. As a farmer and as someone that has worked with farmers for a while and also as a lecturer, I know most times you have consultations with farmers, and especially for new farmers who are part of us today, one thing that they consider is what is the kind of crop that we should grow according to seasons? Because we know sometimes there are major and lean seasons. So how do you choose the kind of crop to grow per season? And what do you consider in relation to lean and major seasons?
Thank you very much. It's good to be here. And thank you for having me. So when it comes to what crops should a new or an entrant farmer grow? It depends on some factors, right? Even if you look at our topic, which is seasonality of production, almost all the crops, you know, have their own season. And then if you look at the weather or the climatic condition of sub-Saharan Africa, and you see that we have two distinct seasons, right? Which is the wet and the dry. And then for farmers, right, because of the peculiarity of sub-Saharan agriculture, you know, space, we are rain-fed, right? What I mean by rain-fed is that we wait on rain, you know, to help us with our production. Mm-hmm. And then if you look at most of these crops, right, they really do not have season, right? Because if you have constant irrigation and all of those things, you can produce all season long, right? So for new farmers, right, for you to know what to produce at any particular point in time, you need to, like I said, depending on some factors. Number one, what are you passionate about? What crops are you passionate about? For me, I'm passionate about grains. And then, so I'm focused on grains. So some will like vegetables, you know, some will like cash crops, you know, some will want to go for perennial plants. And what are you passionate about, right? And the second part is the availability of market. If you are growing any crops and then there is no ready-made market for it, because of the popularity of our, you know, system, you need to have a market, right? To be able to sell your produce and make revenue. And so depending on the location wherever you are, you need to have a market. Where I am in Northern Nigeria, there's a market for grains. So I grow grains and I have a market for it, you know, ready-made market for it. And so in your location, you need to know the kind of market that are there. And also you can actually create the market for yourself, but it's a, you know, it's a hard work for you to grow, to plant, harvest, and still looking for market. It's a hard task. So market, the passion for the crops, and even your financial capabilities. If you are going for cash crops, it takes a longer time to, you know, start reaping harvest. And also it costs a lot of money to be able to have these crops, to be able to plant or cultivate these crops. So your financial capability, what you're passionate about, the market, and even the other thing I also like to talk about is even personally, your level of knowledge, right? I can have passion for grains and I don't know much about it. And so constantly, you need to understand the sector or the crop sector you are going into. And that will really guide you on what to produce, on how to produce them. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much for all that you said. I'm happy you mentioned the level of knowledge, because I believe it's one thing that is very important. And for us at Complete Farmer, we know there is a knowledge gap. So what we do with our grower model is to provide our farmers with the right knowledge. We are providing constant agronomic support, doing the help that farmers need to help them bridge that gap and to grow more. Now, one thing that you mentioned was, one, knowing your markets, being passionate about it, the financial aspect. And I know that for most farmers, when you start your journey trying to understand buyers and those things, pricing is something that you think of, especially how am I pricing my goods? So before we get to the pricing aspect, I want to know from you, Mr. Jonas, as someone that deals with inputs that farmers use a lot. If a farmer is starting his journey and exploring how he's going to farm to meet buyer needs, how does he explore input options for crops? What goes into him selecting the kind of input? Does he go for what is popular, or does he go for what he has researched on? What exactly does he do? And which advice do you normally give farmers?
Thank you, Miriam. As an input dealer, for instance, if a farmer approaches me to advise on what to grow, I think most of our conversations are mainly on grains. So let me stick to grains for the meantime. If a farmer wants to plant, let's say maize, you look at the pocket of the farmer. What is the farmer comfortable with? And also look at how ready is the farmer ready to invest in what he's doing, the level of education of the farmer. There are different types of seeds for maize, for instance, the OPVs and the hybrid maize. They have different costs. The OPVs are less expensive, but they give lower yields, averagely about 1 ton per acre. They are giving you about 1 ton per acre. The hybrid seeds are giving you between 3 to 4 tons per acre. So you advise the farmer on this. Some are more receptive or responsive to fertilizer use and the environment. So you ask the farmer all these questions. You ask the farmer all these questions that you know what best to advise the farmer. Where the farmer is growing the crops, you advise the farmer on that. For instance, if it's cassava the farmer is growing, what is the end market for the cassava? Is it for food? Is it for gari? Is it for starch? If it's for fufu, then you know what to you advise the farmer. Maybe go for tech banchi or banchi hema. If it's for gari, you advise the farmer on the exact variety of cassava the farmer should go in for. So the end market, for instance, if a farmer is producing for a beverage company or a food producing company, maybe let's say Nestle, and you're producing maize. I would advise you, if you're a local farmer, maybe going for Obatampa because there is high protein, or the maize varieties with fortified nutrients inside. That one, the buyers will prefer that one more. They prefer that one more to the locally selected varieties around.
Great, thanks for that. So it's not just picking any kind of inputs, I believe. No, you have to do your research and know what works best for you. And we have Mr. Mohammed.
We're looking at yield. Mm-hmm. The potential yield of the variety you want to grow is key. At it, the potential yield of the variety is key. Yes, and the environment in which you are planting and the season. For instance, if you are doing grains and you are in the dry season, you want to mitigate risk with drought, maybe you can plant Abontem because that one gives you about 72 days to harvesting. So you know that you have a shorter period, you can easily harvest before the drought. Or maybe go for hybrid maize, which is a little bit drought tolerant varieties. Like Opebro is drought tolerant. It's locally produced, so it's acclimatized to our environment. It can withstand drought. So we advise the farmer on all these factors when you are choosing on what variety to grow.
Great. Thank you for that. So I'll come back to you. And is Mr. Mohammed still with us? Great.
Yes.
So, for most of our audience that don't know much about EOS, it may seem something out of reach. But for us here at Complete Farmer, working with you guys has been an interesting experience. I mean, providing support to our farmers with EOS data analytics has been one of the game changers for us. And as Mr. Akintobi mentioned, most of traditional farmers in Africa are rain dependent when it comes to farming. So there are instances where there'll be a season when there's no rain. The unpredictability pertaining to weather is a challenge for many. And I know EOS comes in there. So I want you to tell us how exactly EOS data analytics is using technology, especially in the aspect of weather forecasting for farmers.
So before we actually dive into that, it all starts with global warming, climate change, and what's happening right now. And it's affecting us globally. This is a very sensitive subject for farmers. Now, as you know, the growth of greenhouse gas emissions raises the Earth's temperature, and the consequences of that is very extreme, related to weather conditions and the shifting of seasons. Now, that affects the farmers directly. Last year, the temperature rose by 1.33 Celsius above average across the continent, with West and North Africa seeing an unusual warm year. Even if we're looking at the highest temperature was reached, it was reached in the Algerian Sahara and the temperature was 51.3 Celsius. Now, this is affecting everyone. If you're looking at it, it's affecting everybody. It's affecting the farmers. This type of temperature would affect the growth stages of the plants. It will affect the plants, and it will give it pests and diseases. It will even encourage the growth of weeds. This is something that a lot of farmers would actually have issues with. So as I mentioned, it has an effect on the farmers on the short term as well, and as much as it's on the long term. Some crops might actually benefit from it, but the overall effect is negative on the agricultural lands. So what we would suggest is the adaptation. Farmers can't change the weather, but what they can do is adapt to what's happening. This is where our technology comes in handy. I don't know if anybody have used crop monitoring platform before, but we have forecasting features that provides weather data. This type of weather data and the forecasting feature will help you score a better yield on a short-term and a long-term basis. So through our weather forecasting feature, you'll be able to have access to wind data, humidity, clouds, precipitation data, and of course, temperature data. Based on our recent assessments, plus the feedback from our clients, this type of data is the accuracy rate for it is more than 90%. So this type of tech would even warn you in case you have a heat stress, a cold stress. Cold stress might not affect Africa in particular, but the future is there. And even water stress, this is very important. I saw some person like whining in the chat about there is no water, the water issues. Our technology will warn you where are the places that has less water. After that, if we want to look at the data, how is it formulated? How can we see it? If you check the platform, you will see it in a form of a graph. This graph is easy to use, easy to interpret. You will understand all of their details. Plus, one more thing will be added to the forecasting is soil moisture data. This is very important, especially for African countries. How do we use soil moisture data? We have more than one way and benefit out of it. But the first one, it will help you to determine the sowing dates for your crops. So let's say, for example, the grape seed, it will not be sown in a dry soil. It needs a specific moisture. And this is those type of figures, we will be providing it through the platform. It will help you when to plant your seeds. Other than that, you will be able to use an index, if anyone familiar with indices. This index, it's called Soil Moisture Index. It's obtained through satellite monitoring, and farmers may ensure the crops is successful through this type of index. The last one that I would like to mention is, it might sound a little bit silly to some people, but it's not actually. The excessive soil, excessively moisture in the soil, might put your machinery at risk, and it might even get stuck in this type of soil. You might not know it deep in your fields that you have some areas after of rainy season, but it might even happen. So this is something you will be able to see by understanding the percentage of the moisture in the soil. Back to you, Mary.
Well, that was very interesting, especially the part about how the moisture can even affect your farm machinery. This is the first time I'm hearing this. So it's something new for me. And we have people in the comment section that want to know more about EOS. So I'll be back to you again. So you tell us more about how exactly people can access EOS easily, the process that they go through. So I'll go back to Mr. King Toby. And so he talks to us a little more about the pricing, because pricing is important. Mr. Kintobi. Great. So one thing that you kept on highlighting throughout your submission was, before you make that decision that this is what I want to do, you have to consider everything, including the financial capabilities. Now, as a farmer who is pricing my commodities, what do I look what do I look to or what do I focus on when determining the kind of price that I should put my commodities at? Should I look at market prices, existing prices, or even my production cost? Should I include all those things? Can you please tell us how your experience has been in that aspect?
Yes, so pricing is very important when it comes to, you know, agriculture. Agriculture is just like every other business out there, right? It's all involve all factors of production, which are costs. And you also need to factor all of this thing into your production and then ultimately into the pricing of your products. For me, one of the things I advise farmers and I've done that have been favorable to me is that, you know, we have the, you know, general market price. And the market actually divided into some, you know, some cadres. And so when you grow your produce and you harvest, you want to sell. Number one thing is when you price your produce according to your cost of production. There are markets that will favor you and there are markets that will not favor you. Now, if you have a price, sometimes your price might actually be lower than what is there out in the market, the local market. And so if you carry your produce to the local market, there's no standardized, you know, way of selling at the local market. Factors of production, the factors of demand and supply affect pricing in the local market. So when you go to the local market and then you have a lot of grains, you know, and there's too much grains on the ground, you know, factors that demand and supply comes into play and they beat down the price so people can, you know, so they can sell. And at a point, they won't even look at what the cost of your produce is for them to break down the price, because they feel that, oh, this has to go because there are some trailers already, you know, standing by, you know, to drop their goods as well. And so at a point in time, you might actually lose, you know, when you go to those local markets. And so for me, I think, like I said, you need to find the market. So finding the market doesn't mean that you have to go to the local market. You can actually find markets that are peculiar to the produce that you're making, right? For me, for grains, I package my beans, my rice, or all my grains, and send it to another state where they have a more robust market, where the prices are actually more favorable than your local market. And sometimes I also have off-takers, right, that would price based on their own level. So if you go to the local market, you buy from the local market, people that are buying from local markets will still go out there to go sell, putting their markup. But if you sell directly to these people, you know, you make more money, right? And also looking at the export market, which is also a good opportunity for you. And the other thing I also mentioned is that when you are looking at growing a crop, you need to start, that is when you start your market. Before you even grow your crop or during production, that is when you start looking at your market, because your off-takers will be ready for you when your produce is ready. Because if you are growing cassava and then it is when you harvest the cassava that you're looking for market, you're actually going to run at a loss, because many of these produce, you know, will get spoiled, processing or even storage cost will also affect your price. But if you get off-takers, you get your market while you are producing, by the time you finish production, people are already asking you about your produce, people are already ready to buy. And also, if you look at the seasonality of our production, if you can have a system where you produce all year long, when during the off season, you sell more than during the on season. And so if you're looking at pricing generally, right, the cost of production, if you are looking at reducing the cost of production, then you need to, because market actually determine the price. We have in Nigeria, we have millions of farmers. During the rainy season, now people will be, you know, pushing out lots of maize, right? The market will determine the price. And so for farmers, sometimes we don't have the ability to determine price ourselves. Market determines our price. But the way you can actually be better than the market is to start looking for opportunities for off-takers, look for opportunities for even processing companies, right? For cassava, you can start looking for breweries and all of these bigger companies that will offtake your, you know, your produce. And then looking at even the more standardized markets, those are the places where you can get more, you know, value for your produce. Because pricing is not determined by a farm. Pricing is actually determined by the market. And so for farmers, we are trying to build your business plan, engage the right input that will give you quality and less cost, and then look for a better market that will give you better value for your revenue. Thank you.
Yes, great. Thank you for that. And you mentioned one thing that stood out for me a lot was a practice you do, that is you try to explore other markets. So you don't really focus on your kind of markets, especially with regards to pricing. And yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that as well, because it's one thing we do here at Complete Farmer. We know most times farmers have a challenge with access to the export markets in other markets. So by working with us and by being part of our grower model, we give you the opportunity to access export markets at very good prices. So if you're a farmer here who has been struggling with getting access to other markets, Complete Farmer is here for you. So visit www.completefarmer.com or click on the link in our chat room. And Mr. Jonas, we have so many attendees from other parts of Ghana who are having a challenge with the local name of some of the varieties. And we've had a few people that keep on, they're a bit confused because it's a foreign language. So if some of the varieties, if you could mention some of the varieties you mentioned earlier in English, we would appreciate. But there's a question that I have directly for you. So someone wants to know if he has plans to plant maize and he's based in southern Nigeria. I plan to sell in the open market. So either fresh maize or sell dry maize to open market. Which maize variety do you think is best? And also with regards to the variety, the kind of inputs that should be used. Yes, thank you. And to our attendees, please be dropping your messages, your questions in the Q&A, and our experts will answer all your questions.
Yeah, thank you, Miriam. It will be difficult because some of the varieties are locally bred.
Yeah.
They were bred locally, so it will be difficult. I don't know. I'm not very conversant with our neighbors in Nigeria, the locally bred varieties. But there are a few international varieties that cut across the sub-region. I don't want to be specific on the name of the variety because indirectly, probably, you might be marketing one company over the other. That's why I broadly classify them as hybrids, then OPVs. Oh, that's the open pollinated varieties. And the hybrid seeds. Usually we all know the hybrid seeds have higher yield potential. They have higher yield potential than the OPVs. The OPVs are open pollinated varieties. The hybrid seeds, for instance, the very common ones we have in Ghana that can move around the sub-region is a 30Y89. We have SC719. We have Lake. We have Pana, Pan 12 and the Pana 53. Both white and yellow. So these are some of the varieties the farmer can look out for. They are all responsive. They respond differently to the environment. The hybrids, for instance, require more fertilizer and they give you more. The response to fertilizer is greater. You give them more fertilizer, they give you more. They're like, indirectly, they're like broiler. Like in terms of bird production, they're like broilers. The more you feed them, the more they give you yield. So we recommend hybrid for more yield. We recommend hybrids for our farmers. Yeah.
Thank you for that. So there are some questions coming in. So we'll come back to all those questions. And Mr. Mohammed, yes. So for our audience here, EOS Data Analytics works with Complete Farmer. So it's part of our grower model. And can you briefly tell us how EOS Data Analytics is working with Complete Farmer to provide assistance to farmers, because most people in our audience still feel the disconnect. So telling them that they work with Complete Farmer is definitely the assurance that they need. So can you please tell us how you work with Complete Farmer?
Of course. Complete Farmer is one of our partners. As you know, with such technology, not a lot of farmers can use it or have the knowledge to use this type of technology. That's why we partner with companies such as Complete Farmer to help the farmers, to teach them, to help them adapt to what's happening right now and how to use this type of technology and even provide them with advice. Complete Farmer is one of our best partners in Africa. And we're actually very happy to work with them. If you need anything from EOS, any use for the platform, you can directly contact Complete Farmer and I'm sure they will be more than happy to help you. You're on mute, so we can't hear you.
Great, thank you for that. So to basically get an idea of what EOS does, EOS is the technology that farmers need, especially in weather forecasting. Now you, it seems most people actually, from most of the comments you received so far, is about how it's mainly focused on rain forecasting. But in your earlier submission, you talked about soil moisture and all those things are things that are important for farmers to know about. So how does EOS Data Analytics bridge the gaps in certain aspects relating to the farm apart from the weather conditions? So there are things that farmers are mostly concerned about on their farm. Which other areas that EOS analysis use technology to focus on?
So but us at EOS, it's not just weather data. This is just part of our features that we have. We have a full-on crop monitoring platform. Our platform would help you understand the health of your plant using different indices. It's not just that. What we use satellite imageries to be able, through remote sensing technologies, to be able to identify pests and diseases, the lack of fertilization, the lack of precipitation in a specific areas in your fields. Those are part of the things that you can even use within our platform. It's not only that as well. What we provide as well is historical data. Something that we've discussed, that the issues that they face within their farms, especially with weather conditions. Historical data is very important, not just for farmers, but even for insurance companies, even for banks, even financial advisors, or even micro loan providers. They need to understand the value of a specific field to be able to give it a specific credit scoring. This is how it usually works with those financial institutions. And with us, with the historical data that you get from 2008 till today, and you'll be able to do this type of credit scoring. And this will help, first of all, expedite any type of loan, applications that you ask from those banks. Usually it takes minimum 2 to 3 weeks. But with this data that they have, it could be done within 2 to 3 days. You will get that finance, you get that money. You go to Jonas, I guess, and get the input that you need and plant your field. This is how it works. This is how it is. And with those type of technologies, it will be much better for the farmers and, of course, better for the institutions who provide those loans when they understand that risk.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for that. So there's so much EOS is doing, and technology is here now, and agriculture is changing, is transforming, and EOS is doing so much to change agriculture. And I'm happy you've partnered with Complete Farmer, because that's actually our mission, to redefine agriculture, how agriculture is, that is right from the grower to the buyer. We are redefining how the processes are. So a partnership with you is definitely the way forward. And at this point, we are rounding up. So we have a few questions. And we have one question for Mr. Kintobi. I think, okay, this question, to make it more open. And someone wants to know that particularly in Nigeria, and let's just generalize it to other parts of other African countries as well. How do you determine the kind of market, whether that market is good for you? How do you determine, and where do you find the information to know that this market, is it a trial and error thing? You try, if this market is good, if it doesn't work, next time you go here. Is that what you usually do, Mr. Kintobi?
No, I don't do that. Trial by error, it's not a good it's not a good strategy in agriculture, right? Because you're trying and error with your capital, with your produce, with your money and everything, and even your time. And so we don't have that luxury of trial by error in agriculture, especially farming. And basically what I do is that, you know, in agriculture, there's this thing they call research as well, as it is labeled our product out there. And so there's something they call market feasibility study. And it doesn't have to be something very serious. It can be you walking into the market, asking about price and asking about taking some basic data, right? And so what I do, like I said, getting your market and the pricing is, it's a job that you do during production. And so you can go around, you know, do your feasibility study about the market and even pricing feasibility study and all that. And sometimes when you harvest, it might be time for, you know, bulk harvest and every other farm is harvesting the same thing and the price, you know, shoots down. And then so there's a place where, and that is where the opportunity for off-taker comes in, right? Where you get it at more better price than the local market and even a little bit of processing, you know, maybe it's a vegetable, if it's tomatoes, you can dry and just a little bit of processing. And also that can even increase the price or even storage, you know, and the rest of that. So pricing, no trial by, don't do any trial by error market stuff. Always ensure that you do your due diligence in understanding each of those markets. And that will really help you in terms of getting the right price for your products.
Great, thank you for that. So I think this would be a very open statement. It's from one of our attendees on irrigation sustainability. So Mr. Mohammed talked about how we admit that climate change, there's so much that's going on in regards to climate change. So irrigation is also one of the things that farmers are concerned with. So can any of us, it could be Mr. Mohammed, anything you have to say about irrigation and this sustainability for farmers on here?
Let me add one more thing in here. As through the platform as well, you will be able to know the percentage of precipitation that happened in specific fields. So you will understand the amount of rain that came to those fields and combine that with the data that you will get from soil moisture, you'll be able to know how much irrigation you need for a specific field. And of course, irrigation will differ between specific plants. So each crop will have different type of irrigation. So it needs different soil moisture, it needs different precipitation. So this is why you have to combine all those data together. It's not just one-sided, but it's not just about irrigation, lack of water or having a lot of water. It's having all those data together to be able to do the optimal amount of irrigation for each crop.
Thank you, Mr. Jonas. If there's anything pertaining to irrigation and its sustainability you want to share with us?
Irrigation is, I think it's a technical area, not much of my field. but I think it's an area we encourage farmers to do. We have the mass, the big canal, the dam irrigation system that the government does for farmers as a special irrigation project. We encourage farmers to use more irrigation because this dry season farming, few farmers venture into dry season farming. So when you go into dry season farming, there is higher value for your produce. There is higher value because there is less supply on the market. And like Akintobi said, these commodities are driven by demand and supply. The more the produce on the market, the lesser the price. The less the produce on the market, the more the price goes up. So you read between the lines. If you are doing irrigation in the dry, doing vegetables in the dry season, you know that the value is much higher. Per kg of tomatoes in the dry season in December, in January, is far higher than in April or in June when you are selling tomatoes. So these are areas farmers can also look at. And one thing, just a quick one on the question Mr. Akintobi answered on about the demand on the crops on what to do for the market. Farming is a business. And we always tell farmers, it must be demand driven. It must be demand driven. You should identify the market before you start production. they're supposed to, it's not, you cannot try and see if somebody will buy. You waste your time. You have to know, you have to identify the market, who you want to serve, what you want to serve, or what problem you want to solve, or what deficit you see in the market you want to produce to fill. If that is, that question is not answered, you are going to fail as a farmer. It is demand driven. And I believe that cannot be understated. We have to stress that to the farmer.
Great. What about you, Mr. Akintobi? I mean, as a farmer yourself, in regards to irrigation and its sustainability, how it has been for you so far, what would you advise our farmers to do?
Well, irrigation is very important. Water is very important to farming, right? And I think it's all aspects of farming. Even if it is animal production or even crop production, it's very important. But I think the importance is more felt in the arable production, especially when it comes to the on-season and off-season period. Irrigation is very important, but the cost of irrigation is quite high for the majority of farmers. In Nigeria, if you want to irrigate 1 hectare of land, costs you around 400,000 to 500,000 naira. And that's a huge money, especially for these small-scale farmers that have 3 to 5 hectares of land for production. So it is quite expensive to run irrigation. And so what I advise sometimes is that there's this technique called rainwater harvesting, where you have an expanse of peats where you collect rainwater, and then you can also use that to irrigate later. And also, even the topography of your land also needs to be durable for continuous availability of water. So if you look at the topography of your land, does it support maybe late rainy season farming or even during dry season? And so we also look at that, and then situating your farm very close to the stream or to a dam, that can also help. But I think when it comes to irrigation, right, as much as it's the job of the farmers to get water for their plant, it's also an avenue for the government to come into play, to help the farmers. If you set up a massive irrigation system in a farming community, and they can pay a little, an amount of money that is not too expensive for them, right? And they can continue to farm all year long, continue to produce food all year long. So that is also important. And I think the other aspect of irrigation that I also want to talk about beyond farmers is or beyond government support is also forming a cooperative society, right? If a farmer form a cooperative society, they can pull up funds, to be able to, irrigate their farming communities, right? And so if you come together as a community or an association, a crop association, you can pull up funds and be able to get all of these, mechanized or implement that you can use to, improve your production. And so I think irrigation is very important, but for the majority of people producing our food, it is not affordable for them. Sincerely, it is not affordable because it is expensive. Thank you.
Glad you mentioned the partnerships, because there was a question on that. And I'm glad you talked about partnering with other firms and other places. So someone wants to know if, Mr. Akintobi, would you advise people, especially farmers, to partner with others?
When you say addicts, I'm trying to understand what I mean.
Can you advise on how to go about partnering with addicts? For instance, I live abroad, have some capital, looking for a local partner. So I think the person wants to know, as farmers, maybe forming corporations, like you mentioned, pooling in resources from here and there. Would you advise farmers to go with that, especially with those that are low on funds?
Oh, definitely. That's more like investing in farms, right? If I'm right.
Yeah.
I think it is important, right? For farmers, we pull in funds either from equity, from venture capital, from personal finances, from friends and families, or crowdfunding, right? Yeah. So you have so many avenues for you to to get funding for your farm. And it is important. So if you have the funds and then you look to see a farm that you want to invest in, oh, that's fine. But it is very important that we invest in the right farm, right? And I don't like when you invest in a farm and there's this, okay, I've invested in a farm, I'm waiting for returns. No. Sometimes your knowledge about business can help the farmer. Because for we farmers, there's still these farmers are seeing agriculture as, oh, it's my passion, it's like what I do, what my father gave to me as a job that I have to do. We are still telling them that agriculture is business. You still have to do it as a business, right? So if you are investing in a farm, ensure that you are investing in the right farm, right? I encourage people to do that. Encourage them to pull in funds. Ensure that you are investing in the right farm. And you are also involved in the management. You don't have to involve in the day-to-day, but see what is happening, get reports, advice based on your own experience. And then I think that will really help a lot.
Great, thank you for that. So we are wrapping up right now, and we've talked about so much, right? From inputs to technology to partnerships and everything we've talked about. So yeah, I'm happy with it. And for farmers on here, like Mr. Akintobi said, partnerships is important. Forming the right kind of partnerships is one of the things that is really going to help you to expand your agribusiness. And Complete Farmer seeks to do that with our partnerships. So you can sign up on our grower model to become part of our grower platform to receive the needed assistance and support that will help you to expand your agribusiness. So as we round up, I'd like to know your final words on the issue of understanding seasonalities as farmers. We talked about the input, we talked about market prices. Mr. Mohammed spoke so much about weather and how technology can be used in those aspects. So which advice would you give existing farmers and even new farmers that are struggling with trying to understand seasonalities and what to do as exactly to meet demand? Yeah, I think anyone can go. Mr. Jonas, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Understanding seasonalities when producing. Like we said, across the sub-region, we have two main weather conditions, the wet season and the dry season. Usually in the wet season, around this time, around the southern belt, we are all planting. Around the southern belt, we are planting now. At the point in harvesting, at the time we are harvesting, in June and July, I'm talking about grains. At the time we are harvesting, it is still raining. So we advise farmers to use aflacid to against aflatoxin because your grains might be infected, or you dry after harvesting to reduce infestation of aflatoxin in your grains before you sell. This will reduce, if you don't control aflatoxin in your grains, you can't sell. The quality of your produce will go down and then you get lower prices for your produce. Yes, I think this is my final words to farmers.
Great, thank you, Mr. Akintobi, or Mr. Mohammed can go. Okay, I think Mr. Mohammed can go, yes.
Yeah, so what I wanted to say, what's the most important thing is knowledge. You have to seek that knowledge, find that knowledge either through your own research or find companies like Complete Farmer to help you with it. I would just like to end this with only one thing that I wanted to say is what matters is getting the highest yields with the minimum cost. And this is something that we can actually work with through our platform. So thank you for bringing me here. And I'm very happy actually to listen to everyone in here.
Yeah. Thank you to you for being part of us. And I'm happy you talked about is about increasing your yield in a cost-effective way. Yes, we had a conversation about it yesterday as well. So yeah, I'm happy you talked about it. And I thank you very much for all that you shared on technology. And Mr. Akintobi, will be your final words before we wrap up. Yeah.
Yeah, so seasonality in agriculture is normal, right? Right, because all these produce have their seasons. But what we can do is to overcome that seasonality by making sure that we have strategies in place that we can enable us to produce all year round. And so, but if you don't have that opportunity to produce all year round, you can as well, you know, look at opportunities or strategies or existing platform that can even give you more value for your produce, like complete farmer, you know. And what I'll just say is that thank you for having me here. It's nice to listen to Mohammed and Jonas, and I'm glad to share my own little knowledge about agriculture. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you too for joining us. And our attendees can find you to network as well, because most people are talking about how to get interactive with Mr. Kintobi. Mr. Mohammed, you have social media channels. We can also get interactive with Mr. Jonas as well. Great. So I think Mr. Kintobi's Twitter is Niger Farmer. So our attendees can check him as well. Thank you very much for being here, and thank you for everything you shared. I believe that most farmers are living here with the confidence and the right knowledge that they need in their agribusinesses. And personally, I learned a lot, and I'm definitely going to share with whoever I can, because there's so much for farmers to learn. Thank you once again. And this was an interesting session. So to our attendees, our next session is definitely one you can't miss. We are going to talk more about how to brand your business. Mr. Kintobi and all our panelists talked about the importance of pricing, the importance of knowing your market. All those things are things that farmers should know. Now, our next set of specialists are supply chain experts, agribusiness consultants, people that work with farmers, that give farmers the right knowledge they need to expand their businesses. This year we are expanding. So if you're a farmer who wants to expand your agribusiness to create the right strategy for yourself this year, this next session is for you. So don't forget that we'll have a raffle draw at the end of today's session, where we are going to give amazing prizes to people who stick to the very end of the event and to others who have shared on social media as well. So whilst we wait for all our panelists to join, please send your messages as well. And if you are having issues with signing up with the Grower platform, please drop your email address on the group, on the chat page, and you'll be contacted after the event. So our email website is www.completefarmer.com. Check there to sign up to our Grower platform. And as we get ready for our next set of panelists, please note that our Grower model is live. So if you're a farmer who is looking for an opportunity to increase your crop yield, to export to the international market, and to also receive constant agronomic support, Complete Farmer is here for you. Simply sign up to be part of our Grower model. If you're also a buyer, wherever you are in the world, if you're looking for an opportunity to source commodities, you are looking for a seamless channel from production right to delivery, Complete Farmer is handling that for you. So check out our buyer model as well.